Hello, everybody. Welcome back. This is our second keynote of the OpenFOAM Workshop. I hope everybody enjoyed the training sessions. I know I dipped into each one of them, and they're all quite different, but we're all really interesting. If you have any technical issues, just bear with it, as will always happen on the first day. So this second keynote will be from Professor Natalie Germann from Technical University of Munich. So Professor Germann is going to talk to us about a OpenFOAM framework for mixtures with partially miscible components. And I know you're going to talk about phase fields, which is an interest of mine as well. So phase field models. So I'm looking forward to the talk. So Professor Germann, if you'd like to share your screen and you can turn on your camera and you can start whenever you're ready. So this session is 30 minutes, including time for a question. So if anyone has any questions or just wants to start a discussion, then please put it in the chat or the Q&A.
Yeah, thank you very much for the kind introduction, as well as for the invitation to participate at this year's virtual conference as a keynote. And yeah, before I start, just a moment. Yeah, before I start with my simulations, with my current simulations, I'd like to give you an overview, a motivation why I'm doing these kinds of simulations. As a process engineer by training, I'm interested in how to produce materials with certain functional characteristics, material properties. And this is not something that is not very easy, because during the production we can't look very much inside the equipment and we don't know what is really going on. And for this purpose I'm also using simulations. And let's have a look at at the characteristics of today's commercial products. Usually they are composed of multiple components. And the components have different interactions with each other. Sometimes an interface is formed, and sometimes they mix well together. And yeah, we have several properties such as different viscosities, surface tension that plays a role, but also different phase equilibria. So these are all things that need to be taken into account into the modeling and the simulation. And especially I'm interested in learning how different components, when brought together, can form a nice product. And during the production, we can't look very much inside the equipment, and there are several important processes going on, such as large deformations during mixing or extruding, but also different phase and state transitions. So we can start with a solid and at the end we have a liquid material, or vice versa. And it is important from a modeling and simulation perspective that all these processes are properly taken into account. Today, I'm concerned about the mixing characteristics, the phase behaviors, and I will show you how to model this properly from a physical perspective and how to implement the models into OpenFOAM. And this will give very nice opportunities in the future to simulate large scale industrial processes more realistically. So here a short summary of my concept. So in addition to experiments, I happily work on developing physical models, taking into account the relevant processes, implementing the models into OpenFOAM, and looking at the predictions, and if they need to be further improved, then I start an iterative approach to improve models further until they fit the data satisfactorily, so that I can use them in large-scale simulations. So today it's about mixtures and interfaces, and you know all well how to deal with nearly or completely immiscible liquids. So if we have two liquids that do not mix well, they form an interface, and we can use a sharp interface model such as the volume of fluid method to describe the interface. characteristics, but what one can also use diffusive interface models. And in these kinds of models, we have like an interface with a finite thickness delta. And typically we keep this value small. It's like a value that gives us, that helps us with the numerics. But in principle, we can also think of increasing this value so that we can describe not only immiscible fluids, but also those who mix partially or mix very well. And also an advantage of these kinds of models is that mass transfer across the interface is generally possible. And this is very important when we want to describe advanced mass transport phenomena. So what I will show you is how we can use advanced thermodynamic modeling to account for different phase behaviors. And basically, we do not restrict ourselves to a very small delta, but rather allow the delta B to be determined by non-equilibrium thermodynamics. So in principle, we want to have miscibility to be a function of concentration and temperature. So depending on the state we have, so depending on the temperature we have, but also the concentration we are using of the concentrations we are using for the components, we can have like immiscible system, or it can mix very well. And early in the 1958, Kahn and Hillier developed the equation for predicting phase behavior in the equilibrium state of rest, and they use the double well potential as shown here on the left side. And if we start with a concentration that is here in this unstable region, then the model will automatically go to a condition where it's more stable. And so we will have like a phase separation. So we start with a mixture, but at the end we will have different phases separated from each other. This equation was then coupled with the Navier-Stokes equation and the mass balance equation to describe the whole transport, the whole transport. And here you see a summary of the NSCH model. So we have a total free energy that that includes a double well potential as well as an additional term, a non-local term accounting for non-local interactions, and the transport equation, including mass transport equation, and the Navier-Stokes equation with a surface tension term here expressed in terms of a chemical potential, and a concentration equation with a convective term, and the diffusive term on the right-hand side depends on the chemical potential that is given here above. So a negative aspect of this model is that the important parameters such as interfacial width, surface tension, or surface tension, they all depend on the same model parameters. So they are somehow interrelated, and this makes it somehow a little bit unhandy, which I will show you how to overcome within the next few minutes of this talk. So in our work, we use non-equilibrium thermodynamics, to be specific, the generalized packet approach. And this is just to show you how it looks like the framework. So we have a master equation that describes the time evolution of the physical state characteristics. And we look at the reversible dynamics here, which is the Poisson bracket, and the dissipation bracket accounts for the irreversible dynamics. And this is really where the modeling comes into play. And H here is the system Hamiltonian. So it's the different energy contribution, including the mixing energy. So if you want to learn more, you can have a look at Anthony Barry's and Brian Edwards' textbook, as well as my recent modeling works on the topic I'm discussing today. So the NSCH model can be recast in this framework, and I will show you what the advantage is. So in particular, we have now not only one velocity, we have two different velocities. Each component in the mixture has its own velocity. And the fact that we have a velocity difference is due to the diffusive processes that are taking place that are given in terms of the chemical potential. And then we have a concentration equation. And if you look closely at this equation, you will see that we don't see any diffusive terms on the right-hand side explicitly. So rather, the diffusive terms are hidden in the phase velocity, in the component velocity, as it is calculated here. So the component velocity is calculated as the sum of the total velocity plus a term that accounts for the diffusive processes. And this is somehow the key to avoid undesired numerical diffusion when implemented into OpenFOAM. In the following, I will show you the equations, and I will also discuss how they are implemented into OpenFOAM. And we start with the mass balance equation. So as a template, we use a multi-phase solver, a standard one available in OpenFOAM. To be specific, it's the two liquid mixing foam solver. It's standard solver for mixing two incompressible fluids. And in this solver, it is assumed that we do not account for compressibility effects. So basically we have the total mass balance for an incompressible mixture. The divergence of the velocity has to be zero. And this solver also has a total momentum balance equation that we now have to supplement with a surface tension term. And we do this as it is done in InterFOAM. We add surface tension effects similarly as in this InterFOAM volume of fluid solver. So here we don't make any distinction whether we have a volume of fluid solver or another one. So we just take the same implementation. So why did we not express this term in terms of the chemical potential as it is done, as it has been done originally by the in the NSCH model? So the reason is that we want to extend this framework to more than two components. And in this case, it is more feasible to use this kind of formulation because we have the surface tension as a parameter inside. So it helps us find the right magnitude of this contribution. Now let's go to the concentration equation. In the two liquid mixing foam solver, we have like a standard advection diffusion equation with a convective term and a diffusive term. And these two terms are treated separately. So in alpha EQN dot H, the advective part is solved using the Mullis solver for hyperbolic problems with corrected flux relying on the limiter concept to blend a first and higher order schemes. And on the right-hand side, we have the diffusive term that is solved explicitly in alpha diffusion EQN.H. And this can lead to undesired numerical diffusion. And when we want to have very accurate predictions, this can be a problem. But as said, in our formulation, we pack everything into this advective part and by introducing a component velocity, and this helps avoid us undesired diffusion. And this is somehow the key to our implementation. And here you see further below the averaging of the mixture quantities as it is also done in the original solver, the two liquid mixing foam solver. I'd like to show you what we can get, and we compare the results with volume of fluid predictions. We have two cases. The first case is like a case for low density and low viscosity contrast, and the second case is one that accounts for a high density and high viscosity contrast. So in the first case, we only have bubble rise and deformation. Whereas in the second case, we can also see filament formation and breakup. And we compare the two cases with volume of fluids methods, with volume of fluids results, and we see a very good agreement. We have to say that unfortunately, we do not have a lot of experimental data available, so we are not really sure. Also, with the when it comes to droplet breakup, how the resolution should look like. But as a summary, we are very close to the other predictions that are available in the literature. Now we can further extend this, so we don't not only want to simulate immiscible systems, but also we want to account for different mixing behaviors. And this can be done by implementing a more sophisticated expression for the mixing energy, which we did. So we utilized the thermodynamic equation that is used in liquid equilibria research, namely the non-random two liquid equation. And this can account for different shapes of the mixing energy, so we can, so the whole prediction can range from nearly immiscible up to fully immiscible using the same equation, and it can be easily extended to more than two components. And this is something that is important to us, because in the future we want to extend or include additional components into the formulation. As a check, we did the microfluidics experiments, and we compared the results with our predictions, with our OpenFOAM predictions, and the parameters of the NRTL equation were taken from liquid equilibrium data. So this is not done, so these have real physical significance, because it's a thermodynamic model. And I'd like to give to say a few words about the effective mobility, that is like a time constant in the concentration equation, and the kappa, which is in the known local term of the mixing energy. So the mobility is an important parameter, and it's important not to select this value to be too large. So if it's small enough, then the whole dynamics is really controlled by the NRTL equation. And this is important because we want to have thermodynamic predictions. And it's basically a phenomenological parameter depending on the specific form of the diffusion equation. And it is a nonlinear function of composition, velocity, and temperature, and needs to be adjusted to experiments. So this is a very important point, especially if you want to do industrial simulations. If you want to simulate a real process, these parameters have to be set accurately, reliably, and for this we need a direct comparison with experiments. And kappa is the stability constant in the mixing energy. In our formulation, it's just for numerical reasons to increase numerical stability, but does not have any other effect. Remember, in the NSCH model, it also determined the interfacial thickness as well as the surface tension, but in our case, it's not. And here a few predictions. Here we have a system that is, we have two components, water benzaldehyde. These two components are nearly immiscible, so we expect the formation of an interface if we bring them together in a microfluidics device, and this is also predicted by our model, by our OpenFOAM simulations. And we get also the interface width independent of how we select the volumetric flow rates at the respective inlets. Now let's go to the miscible case. So now we go to the other extreme, from nearly immiscible to fully miscible. So we have a binary system of water and methanol, and these components mix very well. And we start with a relatively low flow rate, and we see the mixing nicely occurring in the channel. And this is also in accordance with the experimental data. And as we would expect, if we increase the flow rate, the mixing takes longer and it goes, so we need more higher distance to get the mixing done. And now the very interesting part. Now we have an example of a system that is more complex. So this system can show both miscibility as well as immiscibility at room temperature, depending on the composition. And also the miscibility behavior, of course, depends on the temperature. And we start with a molar fraction of 0.5. So if we look at the phase diagram, we would expect immiscibility. And this is what is also predicted by our simulations and verified in our experiments. And as a check, we decided to increase the temperature to go out of the this phase. And what we then have is like the miscibility, the mixing of the two components as we expect from thermodynamics. So this is a very nice feature. So now we can simulate mixing processes, separation processes, and take into account the exact phase behaviors of the components. And this is like an additional add-on that has not yet been realized so far. So what do we want to do in the future? In the future, we want to include more components. And also we want to investigate further the dependencies of these parameters on like flow velocity, concentration, temperature, and so on to further improve to make the model even stronger. And this we do by combining our microfluidic setup with in situ Raman spectroscopy to see exactly how much the concentration is in the flow field at the specific locations in the flow field. So using physical models combining these models or implementing these models into OpenFOAM is very powerful. And we demonstrated this. We developed new equations using the generalized packet approach of non-equilibrium thermodynamics, and we used the advantage of this formulation because we don't have any explicit diffusive right-hand side in the concentration equation, which gives us reduces the undesired numerical diffusion, so that we can reliably predict interfaces but also mixing. So what do we want to do in the future? As soon as we have further validated our models and improved the dependencies, we really want to do a large scale simulations. An example of such a simulation is a liquid-liquid extraction process where you have three components. So let's us assume that we want to isolate a component, a protein or something expensive that is produced in the industry. This component is in the mixture. So how can we extract this component from the mixture? So we add, we select a solvent such that the target component prefers to be in that solvent. And this will lead to a mass transport from the mixture into the solvent. And this is now our next challenge, and I hope to present you the simulation soon. Thank you for your attention. And also at this instant, I would like to thank my postdoc who has been doing the simulations and working hard to implement the quite complex equations. And also I'd like to thank the Bavarian Research Foundation for the funding.
Great. Thanks very much, Professor Germann. That was a very nice talk. We have a couple of questions in the chat, which I can read out. So, and there's some more coming in as well. So Holger asks or says, excellent work. You're using the double well potential, which is phenomenological. The thermodynamically motivated potential would be the double obstacle potential. Would you comment on the overall thermodynamic consistency of your approach, please?
Yeah, so the approach is thermodynamically consistent. So we derived all the equations within the framework of the generalized packet approach, which will allow us to also include elasticity in the future, microstructural features. And so the double well potential, I only used because I wanted to show that the original NSCH model can be recast into this framework. But later on, I decided to use a thermodynamic model, which is the NRTL, which is also thermodynamically inspired.
Great, thank you. Abdor then comments, how is the phase field parameter calculated? And also, was the mobility parameter assumed to be constant?
Yes, yes. It's not so easy. Also, in other works, it was observed that experimental values would be smaller. So it's more like a phenomenological parameter, but this parameter depends on flow rates, concentration, temperature. And this is why I also will need the in situ Raman spectroscopy to further validate. So at the moment, I can just validate my simulations by looking at interface formation. But if I have like in situ Raman spectroscopy, I can really see at which location we have which concentration. And this will be important information.
Great. Thank you. We have another one from Axel. So how can we assess the equilibrium ratio between phases and the fugacity coefficient in the mixture?
This is not part of my work. So there are databases also worked out, for instance, by Professor Alt, who has been working until his retirement at the FAU in Erlangen. And basically the NRTL model is a model that exists since years. And for this model, we have like databases for binary ternary mixtures where we can get the data. And these data are determined by, from experiments, liquid-liquid equilibria experiments.
Okay, great. I guess I have a question as well. So it seems that a characteristic of this approach is the casting of the diffusion term in terms of an advection term. That's kind of one of the characteristics of the solution procedures.
Exactly. So when you consider this diffusion term in the equation, then of course you always have undesired diffusion. And other approaches, in other works, the equation was reformulated so that the equation can be solved fully implicitly. But if you have a very complex model like the one I presented today, this is not anymore possible. And with this little trick by introducing the component velocities, the diffusive term disappears naturally. So we have now only an advective equation that we need to evolve. And as you can see, that the results are very promising. So somehow here the mathematics and the physics come together, and it gives a very nice application.
Interesting. And relative to volume of fluid, what are the relative merits, would you say, for solving problems like this?
Yeah, so I think it's... It can be used in complex applications where we have like phase and state transitions, and in applications where we want to realistically mimic the properties of the materials, because many components they are not completely immiscible, but it's something in between fully complete immiscibility and full miscibility.
Great. And maybe one last question for me then is to do with the algorithm. It's currently fully explicit then, I guess. You're propagating the equations explicitly. Is that is that a challenge from a computational time perspective then, or?
No, so I wouldn't say so that it's a challenge. So if I compare these simulations with other simulations I am performing, with scholastic ones, for instance, then it's not very challenging.
okay, fine. So, but in terms of computation times, you mentioned about applying these methods to industrial simulations. So the computational time, that may be one of the main challenges, is it, to make these simulations run in a reasonable amount.
Yeah, I think it all depends on what you want to look at. So in general, diffusive processes can be very can take a lot of time, so until they reach a steady state. So if you want to simulate the whole process, independent of whether we do 2D or 3D simulations, it's time consuming. But if you just want to like have a insight what's going on during the first few seconds, minutes of a process, then it should be no problem.
Thanks very much then. I'll bring this session to a close then. So thanks very much, Professor Germann, for the very nice talk. So I'll encourage people to follow up with you directly in the meeting hub afterwards if they have further questions. So
thank you very much.
Okay, thank you everybody. We have one last technical session which starts in 5 minutes. So I'll see people then. Thank you again. Bye-bye.